Good morning and welcome to online worship at Union Congregational Church. I'm so glad that you clicked the link that brought you here and hope that you will stay with us through this service of worship through song and reading of scripture, confession of sin, prayer, preaching, and we'll also have an opportunity for you to observe communion at home. We'll have a short liturgy for that with all the words on the screen projected at the right time. So if you want to pause for just a moment now and make sure you have something that could serve as the body of Christ and something that could serve as the blood of Christ, any sort of food and drink should work for this at-home communion. I invite you to do that now if you wish. I invite all of us now into a posture of thanksgiving and praise as we enter into God's presence for worship.
A flower in the seed, an apple tree, in cocoons a hidden promise, butterflies will soon be free. In the cold and snow of winter, there's a spring that waits to be unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. A song in every silence, seeking word and melody. There's a dawn in every darkness, bringing hope to you and me. From the past will come the future, what it holds a mystery. Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. In our end is is our beginning, in our time infinity. In our doubt there is believing, in our life eternity. In our death a resurrection, at the last a victory. Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see.
Jesus, I cross my chains. seemed to be lost and it's starting to get dark.
Yeah, and we've seen some strange things along this path.
Sure, follow me. I can lead you to the crossroads.
So, why is your beard green anyway?
Well, I'm a forest wizard, of course. Follow me. Stick close with me. You may see some distressing things, but don't focus on them. Just let them pass by. Don't be afraid. The path doesn't end here. Crossroads are just beyond. This is the crossroads of hope and despair. Now you can choose to continue along the path of despair, or you can choose the path of hope.
We choose hope.
Good choice. Follow me. Thank you.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Our scripture reading is Romans 4, 18 through 25. I'll be reading from the New Living Translation. Romans 4, 18 through 25. Even when there was no reason for hope, Abraham kept hoping, believing that he would become father of many nations. For God had said to him, "That's how many descendants you will have." And Abraham's faith did not weaken, even though at about 100 years of age, he figured his body was as good as dead, and so was Sarah's womb. Abraham never wavered in believing God's promise. In fact, his faith grew stronger, and in this he brought glory to God. He was fully convinced that God is able to do whatever he promises. And because of Abraham's faith, God counted him as righteous. And when God counted him as righteous, it wasn't just for Abraham's benefit. It was recorded for our benefit too, assuring us that God would also count us as righteous if we believe in Him, the one who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead. He was handed over to die because of our sins, and He was raised to life to make us right with God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. God, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts would be pleasing and acceptable to you, O Lord, our strength, our hope, and our Redeemer. Amen. 80% of us have optimism bias. Optimism bias. A neuroscientist named Tali Sharot says optimism bias is our tendency to overestimate our likelihood of experiencing good events and to underestimate our likelihood of experiencing bad events. This optimism bias is why the divorce rate can hover somewhere near 50%, but if you were to poll newlyweds on their wedding day and ask them, "What chances do you give your marriage of ending in divorce?" you'd probably hear something closer to 0%. Optimism bias, Sharot says, is why so many of us say that we are above average drivers, above average intelligence. We have better than average looks. We're more modest than average. But as she points out, we can't all be better than everybody else. You can't have 80% of the world being above average. And it's not that optimism is a bad thing. In fact, this optimism bias has some positive health effects. But one question for us to think about is, what is my optimism rooted in? Is it rooted in reality? Is it rooted in wishful thinking? There's a word that we sometimes use for optimism when we think that something might happen, or at least wish that it would. That word is hope. Hope. I hope I find something good to eat for dinner tonight. I hope there's a vaccine soon. I hope life goes back to normal before long. I hope this candidate wins. I hope you have a good weekend. Those are all fine things to hope for, but hope, as we often use the word, is tethered to circumstances. The better the circumstances, the more we hope for. The worse the circumstances, the more hopeless we can become. This is circumstantial hope. Circumstantial hope is what Abraham and Sarah first tried when God told them that they were going to have a baby. God promises in Genesis 17, promises to Abram that he's going to bring whole nations and kings from him and Sarah. But the Bible describes both of them as old and barren. He was 100 and she was 90. So Abraham and Sarah both have the same reaction. Abraham fell on his face and laughed and said to himself, "Can a child be born to a man who is 100 years old? Can Sarah, who is 90 years old, bear a child?" And then, independently of Abraham, Sarah has the same reaction. She laughs too. I think any of us probably would. Their hope, at least at first, is rooted in circumstances. They look around. Do they have any reason, based on their reality, to think that they can have a baby? I think circumstantial hope is one reason why COVID-19 has been so difficult. If you want to have hope in the circumstances, all you have to do is turn on the TV or scroll through your news feed to see pictures of crowded school hallways or parties where nobody has a mask and nobody is social distancing. That doesn't inspire hope, at least not hope based on the circumstances. Same thing with this racism pandemic. I think of how Austin Channing Brown ends her book, "I'm Still Here, Black Dignity in a World Made for Whiteness." She writes, as a Christian, about the loss of hope. And I think it's circumstantial hope that she has lost, the kind of hope that is tethered to the facts on the ground as we can see them, the kind of hope that requires other people to respond in a certain way. Listen to what Austin Channing Brown says. She says, "And so hope for me has died 1,000 deaths. I hoped that my friend would get it, but hope died. I hoped that person would be an ally for life, but hope died. I hoped that my organization really desired change, but hope died. I hoped I'd be treated with the full respect I deserve at my job, but hope died. I hoped that racist policies would change and just policies would never be reversed, but hope died. I hoped the perpetrator in uniform would be brought to justice this time, but hope died. I hoped history would stop repeating itself," she says, "but hope died. I hoped things would be better for my children, but hope died." So again, we face the question, what or who is the source of my hope? If I'm even slightly optimistic, why? Where is my hope grounded? Do I ground my hope in the good behavior of others? Or in what I can do to bring about change in a situation? Do I root hope in the ability of people and institutions to make better decisions and to do the right thing? Is my hope tied to circumstance? I think all of us have experienced misplaced hope, or a hope that has disappointed us, or a hope that has died. Hope had died too for Abraham and Sarah. So when God promises them something great, they just shrug it off and laugh. Whereas our wonderful family hairstylist says, "I just had to laugh." Abraham and Sarah heard God's promise and they just had to laugh. So God says to Abraham and Sarah, hearing their laughter, hey, is anything too wonderful for the Lord? Is anything too wonderful for the Lord? God wants to steer them away from so-called hope, hope that is rooted in circumstances. God wants them to replace that hope with another, deeper hope, a hope in who God is and what God can do. Is anything too wonderful for the Lord? Do you think my arms are too short to save you? In Romans, Paul writes about these unlikely parents holding up their God-based hope as an example for all of us. Romans 4:18 uses this fascinating phrase, hope against hope. Hope against hope. And I thought maybe looking up the original language would help clarify this funny phrase, hope against hope. But it turns out that Paul wrote hope against hope. He just wrote it in Greek, and now we have it in English. Here's how other translations put it. Against all hope, Abraham, in hope, believed. Contrary to hope, in hope, he believed. Even when there was no reason for hope, Abraham kept hoping. That's the New Living Translation that I just read. Paul is talking about two different kinds of hope. Even when there was no reason for hope, Abraham kept hoping. There's hope based on circumstances, and then there's hope that's grounded in God. And only this hope that's based on God will never disappoint, will never let us down. Even when there is no reason for hope, we can keep hoping like Abraham did. And that's because of what God can do. An interviewer once asked Desmond Tutu if he was really as optimistic as one of his books made him sound, even after all he had been through. And Tutu answered, "I'm not optimistic, no. I'm hopeful. I'm a prisoner of hope." So even if Corona time were to last another year or two, God forbid, we would still not be without hope. Even if there's no vaccine for another year or more, we are not without hope. Even if racism in the United States continues for years and decades, as sadly it probably will, even so, we are not left without hope. Even if you get sick or lose your job or have a falling out with your family or are hurting deeply right now, you are not without hope. Paul writes hope, and he means hope that is grounded in God. Hope, he says, does not disappoint us because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. God's love gives us reason to hope, not in circumstances, but in God. God is our hope. We hope in who God is and what God has done. We hope in who God has been and who God will be and who God has promised to be. We hope in what God will someday do, which is make all things and all people brand new, fully redeemed, fully restored. Václav Havel was a playwright and a Czech dissident thrown into prison for his human rights advocacy. He would later become president of that country, what we now today call the Czech Republic. Listen to how Václav Havel writes about hope. "The kind of hope I often think about, especially in situations that are particularly hopeless, like prison, I understand above all as a state of mind, not a state of the world. Either we have hope within us or we don't. Hope is not prognostication. It is an orientation of the spirit, an orientation of the heart. It transcends the world that is immediately experienced and is anchored somewhere beyond its horizons. I feel that its deepest roots are in the transcendental, just as the roots of human responsibility are. Though I can't, unlike Christians," he says, "say anything about the transcendental. although it seems like he's getting there. He goes on and says, hope in this deep and powerful sense is not the same as joy that things are going well or willingness to invest in enterprises that are obviously headed for early success. But hope is an ability to work for something because it is good, not just because it stands a chance to succeed. He says, the more unpromising the situation in which we demonstrate hope, the deeper that hope is. Are you in an unpromising situation right now? The more unpromising it is, and the more you can demonstrate hope, the deeper that hope is, because it's untethered from circumstances, from the reality on the ground as you see it when you look around. Havel says that hope is anchored somewhere beyond its horizons. Christian hope looks not out, but up to God. Listen to a story that one preacher tells. Preacher tells this story. My mom and my dad used to sing a song. It's an old song out of the Black religious tradition called Thank You, Jesus. It simply goes, thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Lord. And he says, to me, they always sang that song at the strangest times, when the money got low or when the food was running out. When I was getting into trouble, they would sing that song. And I never understood it, because as a child, it seemed to me that they were thanking God that we didn't have any money, or thanking God that we had no food, or thanking God that I was making a fool out of myself when I was a kid. The preacher continues, but I was only looking at the horizontal level. I did not understand, nor could I see back then, that the vertical hookup that my mother and my father had. I did not know then that they were thanking God in advance for what they dared to hope he would one day do with their son and in their son and through their son. That's why they prayed. That's why they hoped. That's why they kept on praying with no visible sign on the horizon. Hope isn't horizontal, it's vertical. Christian hope doesn't look out, it looks up. May we cling to true hope. Hope that is anchored in who God is and what God can do. May we rejoice, as Revelation paints the picture, may we rejoice in the hope that the Lamb at the center of the throne will be our shepherd, and that he will guide us to springs of the water of life, and that God will wipe away every tear from our eyes. Whether or not you have optimism bias right now, whether you think there's any reason for optimism, God calls us to hope in God. Hope against hope. So like Abraham and Sarah, we can be fully convinced that God is able to do what he has promised. And so with the writer of Hebrews, let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. Amen. With your own food and drink ready to partake now in communion, I invite you into the presence of God, which conjoins us virtually even now. You'll find the words for the liturgy on your screen as we partake in this blessed sacrament. As we express our unity by gathering at the Lord's table, we proclaim his death and look forward to his coming again. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Jesus said, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. The bread which I shall give for the life of the world is my flesh. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in them. And so we pray, Almighty Father, whose dear Son, on the night he was betrayed and suffered, instituted the ordinance of his body and blood, mercifully grant that we may receive it thankfully in remembrance of Jesus Christ our Lord, who in giving himself for us
gives us a pledge of eternal life to be appropriated by faith and who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Praying together, most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us all our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in the assurance of our eternal life with you. Amen. Let us pray now in the words our Savior Jesus Christ has taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Jesus Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. I invite you now to receive the bread, the body of Christ. This is the body of Christ, broken for us, the bread of heaven. Take a moment now to receive. This is the blood of Christ shed for us, the cup of the new covenant. Now take a moment to receive. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love you and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And friends, know that because of the sacrifice of Christ in giving his body and blood for us, we are counted as being totally free before the presence of the most holy God. Thanks be to God.
Ya na Dios tiene nada le falta, nada te torbe, nada te espante, solo Dios basta. Nothing can trouble, nothing can frighten those who seek God shall never go wanting. Nothing can trouble, nothing can frighten. God alone fills us. Thank you. those who seek God shall never go wanting. Nothing can trouble, nothing can fight. God alone fills us. Not a day torde, not a day spande, can a Dios tene, not a le foto, not a day torde, not a day spande. Solo Dios basta.
Now receive the benediction. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit.